Vafalítið er hægt að fullyrða að Milton Friedman sé þekktasti hagfræðingur sem nú er uppi. Friedman var lengi kennari við háskólann í Chicago. Hann öðlaðist heimsfrægð árið 1976 er honum voru veitt Nóbelsverðlaunin í hagfræði, en þau fékk hann meðal annars fyrir rannsóknir sínar á neysluhegðun og peningamagnsþróun. Ef til vill á Friedman almenna fræð sína meira þakka frjálshyggju stjórnmálaskoðunum sínum en hagfræði, en frjálshyggju stjórnmálaskoðunum sínar hefur hann sett fram í bókum og sjónvarpsþáttum, en hluti sjónvarpsþáttanna var sýndur hér í íslenska sjónvarpinu fyrir nokkrum árum. Jafnframt því að vera frægur er Friedman og mjög umdeildur og sýnist sitt hverjum um ágæti þeirrar efnahagstefnu sem fyllt hefur verið borð við Chile og af stjórnum Thatchers í Bretlandi og Reagans í Bandaríkjunum, en Friedman og kenningar hans hafa haft veruleg áhrif á stefnu stjórnenda þessara landa. Um alla þessa þætti munum við ræða við Friedman í kvöld og umræðurnar munum fara fram á ensku. To discuss Friedman's theories, policies and field questions tonight, we have three men who have been or are university teachers. Birgir Björn Sigurjónsson at the Economics Department of the University of Stockholm, Ólafur Ragnar Grímsson at the University of Iceland in the Department of Political Science, and Stefan Ólafsson also at the University of Iceland in the Department of Sociology. The rules of the engagement are that we would like you to be as brief as possible so we can cover as much as possible. But before we open up for general discussion and questions, I would like to ask you, Professor Friedman, to give us a brief outline of you, what you see as the ideal society, your personal utopia, if you would like.
Well, my personal utopia is one which takes the individual, or the family, if you will, as a key element in society. I would like to see a society in which individuals have the maximum freedom to pursue their own objectives in whichever direction they wish, so long as they don't interfere with the rights of others to do the same thing. In such a society, I believe you do need a government, but the government has a very limited role. Its role should be to provide for the national defense, to provide for protecting one individual from coercion by other individuals, and finally to provide a mechanism whereby we can formulate the rules that will govern us, the rules that decide what we regard as private property, what we regard as the rights of individuals, legislative process, and as part of that, a mechanism for judging differences of opinion. So you would have essentially, in my good society, a very limited government devoted to the tasks of defense, of justice, of legislating rules, and very little else. The rest would be left to the free individual activities of individuals joined through the operation of a private and competitive market.
At the moment, we have, in your opinion, I guess anyway, too big a government, and very far from the ideal society which you have described. Which would be the best way to attain, to realize that dream?
There is only one effective way to do so. That is by democratic means, by allowing the people to express their views. I have been fascinated by the fact that in country after country you have a paradox. You have what is supposed to be a government of the majority. You have a representative government. And yet that government repeatedly does things that a majority of the people oppose. You go around in the United States, for example, where I know the situation best, and you will find that a majority of the people in the United States think government is spending too much, imposing taxes that are too high, and would like to see government cut back. At the same time, the representatives of the people, through the parliament, through what we call the Congress, you call the Parliament, follow policies which lead to those results that the majority deplore. The reason for that, I believe, is that we have a defect in our governmental institutions. What we have is a situation in which minorities, special interest minorities, are able to exercise undue influence. In my opinion, so far as the United States is concerned, our solution to that is going to be through public action, which will lead to constitutional provisions setting narrower limits on government. That was a device that was adopted in the 18th century by the founders of our country in the original Constitution, and we need to reinforce that, in my opinion, by using the Constitution to set narrower limits on the scope of government.
If we turn now to the economics theories, Birgir Björn.
Well, we had in mind to start this discussion with some question of pure theoretical kind, and then proceed towards more economic policy questions and so on. I recall an article or a lecture given by Professor Hahn from Cambridge at the London School of Economics, where he does not agree that the quantity theorist model passes through what you might call the normal requirements of a modern economic theory. This does mean that he disqualifies the modern theorist standpoint of the monetary school just on the same grounds as the old quantity theorist school. What is your reaction to this interpretation of Professor Hahn's position?
Well, I don't know that I can answer that in detail because I haven't read Frank Hahn's lecture that you're referring to. But the position in general reflects a split that has occurred among economic theorists for at least a century. I wrote an article many years ago on Walras, in which I drew a distinction between Walrasian economics and Marshallian economics. The Walrasian view is that you have to have a general system of economics, general equilibrium system, which will reflect all of the interrelations in the society in one system of simultaneous equations. It's very hard to talk about it without talking about it in a fairly technical sense. It's a general equilibrium system. Hahn is in that tradition. Alfred Marshall, who was a great economist at Cambridge in the 19th century, one of the most important economists who ever lived, had a very different view. His view was that economics should be an engine of analysis, that the purpose of economists is to consider problems and try to construct tools with which they can analyze concrete problems and reach conclusions about the consequences of that. Now, in order to do that, you have to simplify. You can't consider the world as a whole. You have to narrow and concentrate on one particular segment. That's what I call the Marshallian approach to economics. I personally have always regarded myself as a Marshallian and not a Walrasian. I think the general equilibrium system is a beautiful work of art. I think it is very valuable for students to learn it, to get a feeling about the interrelationships of things. But there is no way in which it can be used in practice to effectively to analyze specific problems. And so I have been inclined to view economics as a task of constructing an engine of analysis. From that point of view, both what you call the earlier quantity theory and the modern quantity theory, which are really the same thing, it's not really a different thing, it's a development, a further development of it. From that point of view, I believe those are effective engines of analysis. They deal with a particular problem. Quantity theory is not a general theory. It doesn't tell you very much about what the price of fish is going to be. It tells you a great deal about what the price level of all things on the average will be. It tells you a great deal about what the monetary circulation will be. And I have been inclined to view the quantity theory from that point of view as an engine of analysis. And from that point of view, I believe there is no economic theory for which there is a greater amount of empirical evidence justifying and supporting its main propositions.
Thank you, Bill.
Yes. Well, this was a very large answer or a strong refutation of this position.
No refutation. Don't misunderstand me.
Well, I
think the world benefits from differences of opinion.
Yes.
I am delighted to have people like Frankie Hahn and other people like that, because they develop ideas and approaches which other people can take up another way. So I'm not criticizing him. I'm only saying he's choosing to concentrate in one area, I'm choosing to concentrate in another.
Should we take that to mean as that your theories are not necessarily right, but what, just one of many theories which goes to make of the whole mind of ideas?
That's a different thing. No theory is necessarily right. In the world of science, nobody can be positive. Science consists, whether it's physical science or economic science, it consists always of a set of hypotheses, mm-hmm. which are accepted because they seem to fit the facts to date. But somebody may come along and find a new set of facts.
Mm-hmm. And until they can be disproven.
The Newtonian theory is... Mm-hmm. is succeeded by the Einsteinian theory.
But to take that up to the specific example of your own theories, you were just saying, the validity of theories is found in how well they will fit empirical tests.
Absolutely.
Quite recently, the Bank of England published a report by Professor Hendry in England, in which he runs your most recent work on Britain and America through the rigorous tests of modern economic statistics. And he finds out that they do not fit. And he says in that article that your findings do not stand up to credibility. Have you attempted to refute Hendry's conclusions? Because it seemed to, by what you just said before, that you would have to do that if you want to continue to claim validity for your own theories.
Well, let's take that up. First of all, I don't believe you've described accurately what Hendry has done. In the second place, I don't think it is correct to describe the methods he applied as a rigorous modern methods. What Hendry has done is to criticize my colleague Anna Schwartz and myself for not applying, in a work published in 1982, statistical techniques that he published in 1983. Now, I'm guilty to that charge. Absolutely. Those techniques that he regards as the most advanced are experimental techniques that he has been producing that have not yet criticism of other people in the field of econometrics, that are very far from being accepted techniques of analysis. In conference in Boston, under the auspices of the National Bureau of Economic Research, in which one of the sessions dealt with the Hendry papers. The commentators on that were severely critical of the techniques and methods he had used. Now, to go back, he did not examine the argument of our book. What he did was to say we attacked the wrong problem, we should have attacked a different problem, and that our results are not valid for the different problem. But we weren't talking about that problem. Moreover, his paper dealt with a very small part of the book. I have always felt that a book is like a child. I have a son. When he grew up, he went out into the world. He had to live his life. I wasn't going to spend my time defending every last bit of his. In the same way, when I've completed a book, I have allowed it to go out in the world. I want it to be subjected to scientific controversy. The answer to whether Hendry's criticism is valid or not will not be given by me. It will be given by other econometricians who analyze his procedures, his methods, his work. So far, such analyses as I have seen of that kind suggest that he has not succeeded in his alternative method. He has, in supplementing his paper at the Bank of England. Mr. Hendry attempted to apply his methods to produce what he regarded as a superior analysis of the data. The data he used were our data. He took them from our book. That analysis is subject, as it happened, to exactly the same criticisms as he levied against our analysis. But I agree with your fundamental point. If it turns out that his work demonstrates that our results are wrong, then our theory will have to be revised, of course. Mm. But he is very, very far from doing that as of the present moment.
Gentlemen, I would like to remind you, just for a second, to be as brief as humanly possible.
Yeah, I've just put one sentence following that, and that is a rather surprising view.
when you have published a very great work, which is one of the cornerstones of your contributions in recent years, and then out comes one of the most noted econometricians in England today.
He isn't one of the most noted econometricians. I beg your pardon. In England today.
And then you say it is up to other people to prove that he is wrong. It's no concern of yours.
Of course it's a concern of mine. But science is a cooperative enterprise in which many, many people cooperate. I have published other books. I haven't spent my lifetime trying to answer every little criticism coming from anybody on that. Mr. Hendry may well be one of the most effective econometricians in Britain, but Britain at the moment is a backwater in economics. The major econometric, major location of econometric work is not Britain, it's the United States, and Mr. Hendry is very far indeed from being one of the major econometricians in the world. Let's get things straight.
So what you're in effect saying is that the criticism which has been leveled against you by Professor Hendry is really not significant enough for you to answer.
I'm saying two things. Number one, it is with respect to a kind of work that is not my specialty. I am not primarily an econometrician. I am an economist. One set of methods and techniques in our book. That set of methods and techniques produced results which I think will hold up, have held up, have not in any way been questioned by what Mr. Hendry did. Mm-hmm. The techniques which Mr. Hendry used are of an altogether different kind. He used techniques that are highly experimental, that are extraordinarily complicated mathematically. I am not competent to analyze some of that, some things. That's not my field of specialization. And there are other people who are far more competent in that area. In the course of time, they will examine it. That's what I say. Science is a cooperative venture in which many people participate. It's not a single person. Einstein did not conduct the experiments that tested his theory. Should he have? Millikan did so because his field was experimental physics. Einstein's field was theoretical physics.
Back to economics.
I think it's very important here to hear a comment on the major results of Mr. Hendry and Erickson, because they find out that the money demand function is not stable of the kind that you presume.
That's not what they found out. What they found out, what they argued, was something very
different.
That's
precisely what they say they found out.
Yes. But you disagree that they did find out. Well, they didn't find that out at all. What they did was something else. Let me explain the situation. We were trying to separate out the movements from cycle to cycle, the longer-term trend. We deliberately tried to eliminate the intra-cycle movements.
What kind of time frame are we talking about when you talk about longer cycles?
Our book covers a period of over a century.
Right.
The individual units vary in length from about 1.5 or 2 years to about 4 or 5 years. So we're talking about half cycles.
Right.
The basic unit, you see, a cycle consists of an expansion and a contraction. And our basic units are half cycles, either an expansion or a contraction. Mr. Hendry's main criticism, main comment, this is why I say, he said we decided to go to New York and he thinks we should have gone to Boston. Because his main criticism is that we divided the data in this way, instead of treating all the data at once and trying to get one theory that would cover both the movements within the cycles and the movements between the cycles. He asserts that we do not have a stable demand function for money, what he is saying is that his investigation, using the data continuously, not breaking it down as we he was unable to derive from that a function that would apply both within the cycles and between the cycles. And I don't regard that as a very surprising thing. I think the phenomena that occur within the cycles are of a rather different kind than those that occur from cycle to cycle.
Carrying on the discussion on economics, I think we have to be very brief, but you have a further point to make.
Yes. Are you then saying that you already knew it before you manipulated your data from the phase data, from the annual data to the phase data, that you knew it? that the demand function and the velocity function would be unstable.
No, excuse me. No, you have to...
First, you have to say... Did I hear you correctly that you said that Professor Friedman had manipulated the
data?
He had
transformed the annual data...
Of course I manipulated the data.
Yes, for his cycles.
I don't doubt that I manipulated the data. Every statistician manipulates the data. Okay. The fellow who corrects a series... I have a series of data. And you're all acquainted with correcting them for seasonal variation. You can describe that as manipulating the data to eliminate the season. So I have no, I'm not concerned about what
just to summarize what exactly you use, in one sentence.
But I want to go to your point. What do you mean new? We always start out any study with some tentative hypothesis. We don't really know in any field. We start out with a tentative hypothesis, and we try to see if the data we're examining fit that hypothesis or contradict it. If they contradict it, we try to develop another hypothesis which is consistent with those data. So, of course, the reason we decided to try to separate out the intracycle movement from the intercycle movement was because we started with a tentative hypothesis that the demand function for money would be different within cycles, that the factors that would affect the quantity of money people hold in the short term would be different from the factors that would affect what they would hold in the long term. But let me emphasize, the problem of the demand, you know, in our major book, in the book you're talking about, there are two chapters devoted to the demand curve for function for money. There's also a chapter, a very long chapter devoted to behavior of interest rates, which has not been involved in this at all. There's a chapter devoted to long cycles, which has not been involved in this. There's a chapter devoted to the relations between Britain and the United States, which has not been involved in this. So let me emphasize that we're talking about a very small part of a very big book.
Right. Yes, I know that. Brief comment, or shall we carry on to the political...
My point was that this type of transforming data from annual data to phase data was a novelty, was a new thing.
No.
When it was done, well, okay, it was not the regular thing.
I beg your pardon.
And my second point is that you choose the periodization of the model on the grounds of the monetary data, or didn't you?
No.
Or by some other method.
No.
But that is pretty subjective.
No. Method. No, you're quite wrong. The periodization, the problem of breaking it down into the cycle, was pioneered by the National Bureau of Economic Research by Wesley Mitchell and Arthur Burns in a book that was published in the 1930s. The National Bureau, for decades, carried on a series of business cycles in various fields in which the concept of separating out the cyclical from the non-cyclical was a major part of it. There are dozens of books based on that technology. The dates we use for periodizing the data were the so-called reference dates chosen by the National Bureau of Economic Research on the basis of a broad series of figures. They were not dates that we chose from the monetary figures at all.
Good. Right, okay. Stefan, you haven't participated in the discussion, and no doubt that you're willing and eager to take part.
Yes, Professor Friedman, I'd like to take up some of the more theory. One of the main themes of your many books is the criticism of the role of government in Western society. And this comes up in various books, various works in relation to various issues. And you give many reasons for this criticism. One of the general reasons is that the bigger the government is, or the public sector, the more inefficient will the economy be, the lower rates of economic growth and lower levels of living will follow. When today we look at the empirical facts and compare societies in the Western world, we find that there are many exceptions to this. And we have cases of societies in Europe where you have a very big government, governments which take in a big share of the national income through taxes and duties and redistribute this again through the society, and also where you have more government regulation of the economy. I could mention, to keep this concrete, mention one society in Norway, which is close by here. In Norway, the government takes in about 50% of the national income for redistribution, spends it on schools, hospitals, old age pensions, and so on. In the United States, the government takes for similar purposes about 30%, just over 30%.
A little more than that. More than that.
Yes, just over. It's been increasing recently.
Well, if you take local and state governments, it's about 35%.
Yes, but the state government is around about the 30%. Yeah, the main issue is that this is a big difference. It's almost twice the size of the public sector in Norway is a little less than twice that of the United States. But unlike what we would expect from your theory, Norway has actually done much better than the United States in economic growth rates recently. Even if we take a longer period like the period from 1960, this would seem to fly in the face of your theory.
Let me go back on several points. In the first place, I would like to stress that I have written two kinds of works. I have been involved in two kinds of things. One class of work has been scientific, primarily concerned with the scientific issues. Books like The Monetary History of the United States, books like The Monetary Trends that we were just talking about, book like A Theory of the Consumption Function. Those books are not about politics. Those books do not involve any political policy. In some cases, they do involve criticism of particular government episodes. For example, in our Monetary History of the United States, I think we demonstrate very greatly that the Great Depression in the United States was largely a result of bad monetary policy by the Federal Reserve. But that's not a historical observation about what actually went on. On the other hand, I have written a set of books, of which Capitalism and Freedom, Free to Choose, Tyranny of the Status Quo, all of which in association with my wife, are explicitly political. So that I regard my interest in politics as an avocation, not a vocation. I am primarily an economic scientist. And I think you will look long and hard in any of my scientific books to find the proposition you stated. It isn't in there. There's not a single word in any of those books that deals with the question of whether a big government is good, bad, or indifferent. That subject I have dealt with in the works which I regard as political. Okay, now let's turn to that.
But that's a correct reading of the political work
you've done. That's a correct reading of the political works. I'm not questioning that. I'm just trying to make the distinction.
Yes.
Because I think it's very easy for people to confuse the two and not to recognize that
perhaps
see, there's a broad science of economics, which is non-political. I should explain to you.
Take the
monetary theory. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I just wanted to say that some of your followers in this country deliberately try to confuse your scientific criteria with
Well, they're not here at the moment to answer for themselves.
Let me answer for me. And let me point out to you that so far as my monetary theory is concerned, it has been followed in China, in communist China, as well as in capitalist Britain or capitalist Japan. The monetary theory in particular is a non-political theory. Karl Marx was a quantity theorist, so it really has no political content. On the other hand, the point you make is a valid point. I do believe that in and of itself, a large government sector is a factor which is adverse both to political freedom and economic prosperity. Now, the question of the circumstances under which a large government sector will do harm and how large it has to be to do harm depends very much on a number of considerations. One of those, a very important consideration, is the homogeneity of a society. A large government sector will do less harm in a relatively homogeneous society than it will in a heterogeneous society, because in a homogeneous society, people tend to want more or less the same thing, their values are much the same, and therefore, that group of people can more readily agree on what government can do with less division from it. A second very important factor that is particularly relevant to countries like Iceland, like Norway, like Sweden, is the extent to which they are open economies, open to the rest of the world, and dependent on foreign trade. Both Norway and Sweden have been very largely open economies, in which they have had a very large sector of international trade, as Iceland does. It's a very large international trade. And that means, with respect to that sector, government can't mess it up. There's a world market in which they operate. They are subject to
It's interesting to note that in Sweden, where in the last 5 years or so, government has been much more involved than it was before in that sector. Sweden is having increasing economic difficulties. It's very far. There are very few people in Sweden today who would give the kind of universal approval to what's going on there that they gave 15, 20 years ago. Now you come to Norway. You left out of your description of Norway one very, very important fact. You know what that is. That's the discovery of oil. And of course, the discovery of oil in the North Sea is a bonanza which enabled. Saudi Arabia is not a democratic country. It's not a capitalist country. But it's a very rich country right now.
That's
why?
I agree
because
with
it found
that.
Oil.
Yes.
And
that's why you went
no
back
doubt.
To 1960.
I went back to 1960.
No, but if you take it from
I'm
1960
talking about
on,
average.
If you take it from 1960 on, the fact of the matter is that the level of living in the United States, the level of output in the United States is distinctly higher than it is in Norway, has been all along. It is always very much easier for people to imitate and to innovate. It was much easier for Japan, for example, to have a much more rapid rate of growth in its early years because it started so far behind. A country which starts way behind the leading countries can have a more rapid rate of growth. You have to look at two things, not only the rate of growth, but the level of living.
Well,
now,
I
if
think
you take
Norway,
Norway
for that, Norway has an extremely high level
yes,
of living.
Well,
what
so
was
it
started in
1960?
When, at the start of the this point of discussion, where did the United States have to go from in 1960 and where did Norway have to go from in 1960?
That's
isn't
true.
That
it
the
was
point?
Higher at the time, but...
it's still higher today.
It depends on years. Like if we take 1980, Norway was higher. GNP
it depends
per
on exchange
capita.
Rates.
Well, I mean, here these are the standard the measures. We apply these measures
yes,
to all the countries in all the years, so we can draw the conclusions yeah. both ways.
Yeah.
And this actually proves the point that Norway has been above. But I just mentioned Norway to have one example. I could have mentioned other countries.
Yeah.
Sweden has a better record in many senses as well.
It does.
Average levels of living and economic growth rates. Even slightly better. That's not a great
deal. Well, let's
deal
look
of
at the facts.
Difference.
Let's look at the facts. At the moment, as you quite rightly say, the average level of government spending in the United States is about, it's much too high in my opinion. It's about close to 35% of the GNP, over 40% of the national income. On the average in the continent of Europe, it's 50%. In the past 20 years, there have been 20 million new jobs created in the United States. Total employment has gone up by 20 million. The number of people employed on the continent of Europe today is lower than it was 15 years ago. In the past 18 months, there have been 6 million new jobs created in the United States. On the continent of Europe, there have been zero new jobs. Unemployment today is as high as it was then or higher. So that it's pretty clear that what happens is if a country, you see, you have to ask which is a horse and which is a carriage. A wealthy country, a country that does well and performs very effectively, can afford a larger government than a country that does poorly. But as the size of the government increases, it becomes a handicap and a hindrance. And the question remains whether if Norway permits the size of its government to continue to rise, it will or will not. Be a success? I think it will not.
I just want to make the point that I'm not saying that a big government is something we should ask for. I believe in it would be ideal to have a small government, but my point is that the empirical facts actually go against your theory on this issue.
No, excuse
me. You can't deny
we
it.
We have
because,
to look at all the empirical facts. Take a case. Let me give you a counter example. Here's Japan. In the 1980s, Japanese government spending as a fraction of income was roughly half of the United States. Its rate of growth was 10% a year. In the past 5 years, Japanese government spending has been rising rapidly relative to national income, and it's now as large as it is in the United States. And the rate of economic growth in Japan now is about 2%.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but Japan is also a bad case for you because one of the things you have against government intervention, government regulation, is that it has its negative effects. And Japan has a small public sector in the sense of taxation, relatively
not
small.
Any longer.
Well,
not
relatively
any longer.
Small, but as regards regulation, the Japanese economy is a much more regulated economy than the United States one, but still they've done much better.
Excuse
a lot
me?
Of the lot of the investment which goes into Japanese industry and research and development is channeled through public funds.
I think that's been greatly misunderstood and misconceived. MITI, mm-hmm. the Ministry of Industry and Trade, makes great claims. If you look at the success stories in Japan, none of them have been through government. Sony was a private entrepreneur who did not get any government encouragement whatsoever. He built up Sony. Honda, I'm sure some of you drive Honda cars. Honda was not a government program. It did not get any government support. It has been a great success.
But what about the Mitsubishi Corporation?
The Mitsubishi Enterprise was a major enterprise before the government entered in. If you take the Mitsubishi Enterprises, the steel works did get government assistance. They are in great troubles now because there's a great overcapacity of steel around the world. The most prominent Japanese successes have been the ones where they've really made a dent have been in electronics, television, automobiles. In all of those cases, it's been by individual entrepreneurs without, or in some cases against, the desires of MITI. Japan is a fascinating case. I spent a lot of time in Japan, and the one thing I learned about Japan is any statement you can make about Japan which is true has an opposite statement which is equally true. If you say that the government plays a large role in business in Japan, you're right. If you say business plays a large role in government, you're right. If you say there's a large element of monopoly in Japan, you're right. If you say there's a large element of competition in Japan, you're right. For example, you know that Japan is almost the only country in the world that I know of where there are private highways conducted for profit? The railroads in Japan are part government, part private.
Well, it's a fascinating mixture. Mr. Grimson wants to make a point.
A very interesting discussion because I think it illustrates very well the methodology which you usually imply.
Did you say methodology or mythology?
No, well, I could have said mythology because part of it is I feel it that. Because as you said yourself before, you draw a distinction between your scientific work, which some other scientists have been criticizing very heavily, although you have wanted to downplay that criticism in this discussion. And then there is another area of your work, which is sort of political theory, in which you participate in a general political debate, trying to advocate your ideas, not on a scientific basis, but on a general basis of competition between ideas. But there are a few countries where the governments have adhered to your recommendations and where one has a real life situation. And you said at the press conference here yesterday that in the first years in Chile, the government followed your recommendation and it got excellent results. And to many people who have heard of you as an advocate of freedom, it is a surprising paradox that a country where you have a military dictatorship, where a lot of people, even thousands of people, were imprisoned for their views and some killed, where human rights were almost completely abolished, where political parties were banned and there was no freedom of information or the press or so on, that in such a country of this nature, your theories can be a success.
Well, how do you explain the fact that in a country like China, which satisfies every one of your description, those particular scientific theories have also been a success.
Well, I think that because there's some great similarity between some of the political system of China
and
some of the...
Well, how do you explain the fact that in a country like Japan, which it does not correspond to your description, the same theories
have also
been a success?
I can understand why you want to avoid to talk a bit about Chile.
But I'm glad to talk about Chile. I'm not trying to avoid it at all.
But let's talk about it in concrete terms.
Of course, be glad to.
Let us talk about it how it is. That,
let's talk about Chile in concrete terms. Yeah. Let's talk about the fact that my participation in Chile... Can I explain first what my participation in Chile was? Because it seems to me that's highly relevant to this discussion. My participation in Chile has two parts.
It has to do with the fact that the University of Chicago had a contract with the Catholic University of Chile before the period we're talking about, in which they sent students to Chicago to be trained. We sent people down there to help them in providing their education. And as a result, we trained at the University of Chicago many highly skilled economists who played an important part in economic policy. In the second place, in 1975, I spent exactly 7 days in Chile giving a series of lectures. You will be interested to know that one of those lectures was entitled The Fragility of Freedom and dealt with precisely the threat to freedom from a centralized military government.
No, but
you will also know that aside from those 7 days which I spent in Chile at that time, I have had no connection with the Chile government. I have never been an advisor to the Chile government. I have never refrained from criticizing the political system in Chile.
That's not the point.
Professor, I don't think that anybody wanted to imply that you were in any way responsible for the society in Chile.
I was not saying you were responsible for people being killed. The point I was trying to make, but I would have made if you hadn't interrupted, was that you claim to be the theorist of freedom. When you're asked to give an advice in this country, you gave one word, freedom.
Right.
But at the same time, you are on record here in this country as saying that a country which is among the most severe military dictatorship in recent years applied your economic theories truthfully. And a point I just want to bring out, and it seems that you have now acknowledged it as being true, that your economic theories can be applied either in a rigorous dictatorship of the proletariat, like in China, or in a dictatorship by generals.
Look, are you going to say that the law of gravity is different in China and in Chile than it is in Iceland?
No.
All right, there are certain aspects of economics, as I explained before, which are scientific in character. The law, the quantity theory of money, is a scientific law. The statement that inflation is always and everywhere a monetary phenomenon is a scientific law and not a political law. It is like Newton's law. If any country, whether it be a dictatorship, a democracy, whatever it may be, prints too much money, you're going to have inflation. If any country, whether it be a dictatorship or a democracy, wants to reduce inflation, it must reduce the amount of money it prints. Now, those are scientific laws. They have no political content. As I was explaining to you before, you can, whatever your political views are, look, I don't understand you. Are you saying that if you have certain political views, you should only use one kind of physics?
No, I'm just saying that there is, in the presentation of your views, no clear dividing line, as I think has become apparent in your replies to the previous questions. No clear dividing line between your general political theories and what you call your economic theories.
There
is not a clear box of your economic theories and not a clear box for your political theories. And that is why I think many of the profit-making forces, the big business side, those who want to advocate less taxes so they have more money, have, if I may say so in all politeness, taken you on as a guru, because they find this kind of mixture very convenient for them to propagate their own political theories and give it a kind of semi-scientific gloss.
I take it you think the automobile companies have approved my opposition to import quotas from Japan. I take it you think that the steel companies have approved my writings protesting vigorously against imposing tariffs on steel. You are quite wrong about big business taking me as a guru. When I say what they believe in, yes. When I say what they don't believe in, no. Now, let me go back to your fundamental question, and let's see if we can make a little order out of it. Every political question has several elements. One element is, what objectives do you want to achieve? That's a value question. That's not scientific. That's a question of values. The second question is, what means do you use to achieve those objectives? Now, that's a scientific question. The question of whether, if you do such and such, it will have such and such effects is a scientific question. There are no pure, in your sense, there are no pure political questions, issues. The question of whether you would like to travel, let's say if you're in the United States, whether you'd like to travel to New York, Chicago, that's a value question. The question of whether, in order to travel from to New York or Chicago, you have to take a train or an airplane, that's a scientific question. So, of course, there cannot possibly be a complete separation between scientific questions here. The physicists who worked on the atomic bomb were applying scientific methods. The decision to use a scientific bomb was a political question, but that whole issue was a mixture of political and scientific issues. What I am trying to say is that certain parts of my work have been concerned with a scientific issue of what will be the consequences of doing certain things. Now, where I get political is when I come to the question of what do you want to do those things for? What is your objective? Look, if you want to produce inflation, as a scientist, I can tell you how to do it. From a policy point of view, I'll say you're making a mistake.